CNMAT, the Center for New Music and Audio Technology.
Hi, Eleanor. She's doing the video. This is Cinema Verite of CNMAT.
And the second one I'll stick into the phase. They put the oscillator. And this guy. Now a modulation index. It's more pleasing to have index. Indices move a little slower like that. Okay. So there's a new network, which everyone knows what it would do.
Let me just give you a brief agenda here of what we have in mind. I'm just going to say a few words about the center. Then Adrian's going to make a very brief presentation trying to cast some of the problems of music in terms of computer science, so we can see that one of the things we think is that there are lots of real fundamental computer science issues that computer music addresses, and it's a very interesting vehicle for doing interesting computer science. One of the points that we're wanting to try to make. I want to then show briefly a programming language that we've been very much involved with. And the author of it happens to be here, Miller Puckett, in the back of the room. It's called Max, and I'll give a brief demo of how it works. And it's an interesting programming paradigm, I believe. And we've extended it in various directions here. And then Miller will be giving a demo of his signal processing extensions on the I-60 processor downstairs. We're also going to talk a bit about some neural network. Mike Lee will talk about the network stuff that he's embedded in this environment. And then we'll talk about the DSP work that Adrian and Keith Gordon have done to extend it to our multi-processor environments. And we'd also like, we're very much interested in a new computer that's just become available. It looks like a spectacular machine for audio purposes. It's the new Silicon Graphics Indigo. So we'd like to demonstrate that to you. We're very excited about that. And the SGI people have come, and so we're interested in showing them what we do at the same time and showing you their new product. And then what we'd like to do is have these sort of rotating demos. And so there'll be a sort of wandering around the building. Downstairs, Miller Puckett will be demonstrating Center for New Music and Audio Technologies. It was conceived by one of the professors in the music department, Richard Feliciano, in 1987. And the university agreed to establish a position in the music department for this, for a faculty position in the music department for a music technologist, if you will. And I ended up being lucky enough to get that position. The university also bought a building, this 1750 Arch Street estate, if you will. There's a tennis court out back. If someone wants to come up and go to work on scrubbing it down and making it usable, we'd love that. But we'd have to do that on our own. We have a nice garden and so on. And the building will be renovated as of about, the renovation we expect to start about November 1. That's even incorporating some delays that we're anticipating. And basically this will be a seismic upgrade and a handicap access upgrade and new finishes everywhere and some acoustical isolation, et cetera. So the building will be much spiffier than it looks right now. We're actually in the process of preparing to move to an office building temporarily downtown Berkeley while the renovation takes place. We expect to be back in here on June 1st at the latest. We're optimistic, I hope not too optimistic, but I think 6 months is a good time for that. Now, I want to say a few words about our affiliations. We're loosely connected to the music department. We are a provost of arts and letters, Carol Chris, and we view ourselves as a highly interdisciplinary center. We really want to attract students from various different disciplines, mathematics, computer science, electrical engineering, psychology, and we want to bring these disciplines together here and focus them on issues of musical, potentially musical interest. And we'd also like to help work with other departments, so on, when it comes to sound and digital signal processing, particular audio signal processing. So we really believe that the sort of rubbing together of all these disciplines is what makes us interesting, and we want to continue to pursue that. So you can think of this as a kind of territory on which a lot of intellectual free trade is supposed to take place among the various disciplines. Now, we have a very streamlined staff. We have one administrator, Leslie Delehanty, who's in the back there, and Adrian Fried is our key software person. Guy Garnett also handles the software end of things, and that's the core. These are the people who are paid. The rest of us, I'm lucky enough to have a professorship, so I get my pay from the music department, and so does our professor now, and others who might want to be affiliated with us. And we're also lucky to have some graduate students around as research assistants, Brian Link, who's in the back, and Mike Lee, who will be speaking, both of whom will be speaking today. One question you might ask, where does our money come from? Well, we get a small, this sort of operating budget comes from the College of Arts and Letters, and we hustle a lot for outside funding, and as you all know, that's a lot of work, and sometimes in this country, unlike France, we're affiliated with it, it's hard to get music into the act. But I think when you see what Adrian presents, and he's got a punchline at the end of his talk that I think is fairly telling about that one can do interesting computer science work and have music be the focus and subject matter. Now let me just turn things over to Adrian right now, and he's going to make a brief presentation of some challenges.
That music is inherently real time. We're interested a lot in what musicians do when they perform, providing systems and tools for them. And what characterizes the kind of real time is it's called in literature hard real time. In other words, the fixed latencies that you establish have to be guaranteed by the system. It's not like waiting for a note to happen. The musician has to feel he's in control. And the fact that it's around a millisecond makes it much harder than most military industrial control real-time applications, like flying airplanes. We need very high reliability, and one of the weakest links we have is just electrical power. Most touring artists consider, if they can afford it, carrying around backup electric generators. And this is an old problem, as I just discovered. This is the redundant power generation system of a 17th century pipe organ. I don't know much about the technology here, but it looks like if you want a louder sound, you hire more slaves and they stick their feet in these holes here. So. Not sure that the system's completely redundant, but you, organists tend to consider the same kinds of problems people do building large multiprocessors. You have to count the number of organ pipes in a cathedral organ and realize there's a lot of processing there. So I suspect that the two sides are redundant. In case your slave team gets tired on one side. So fault tolerance is a very important consideration. instruments do break. Usually, string instruments, you lose one string at a time. I've never seen a piano completely collapse in heat on stage waiting for a reboot. Although, downstairs, we do have a piano with a computer connection, and Miller will demonstrate that as part of his talk. So putting some of these issues together real time, David later on will introduce Max, which includes scheduling, all the user interface, and all the other considerations for satisfying those constraints. The other problem we have is processing power. If we were to try and simulate a piano, we need roughly a giga operation per second, and the operations need to be just a little bit better than what's standard on most DSP chips. Which processors these days, we need a little bit better than 24-bit and a little bit better than 32-bit floating point. And the algorithms are difficult. They're instruments, if we're trying to simulate instruments, we do other things, but that's something that's very popular right now. They are made from interacting, time-varying, non-linear, and almost linear pieces. And current DSPs are optimized for linear operations on fixed coefficient systems. We're just starting to see that change with the interest in adaptive filtering. But for the most part, there's not a very good match. I'll be talking later on about a system we've built which doesn't get close to the giga operations per second, but what we could afford to do, it's 108 million operations per second, which will do a fairly convincing single note for piano. Piano has 88 keys, which you may want to play all at once. Miller will talk about a new music workstation using much more powerful processor, IA60. The other problem we have is high data rates. These are the rates in megabytes a second for audio applications. If we could afford it, I'm sure actually we could make use of 8 channels in the home. Right now we're talking about 6 typically in the home with a Dolby surround system. But film regularly uses 120, large feature films can use 200 simultaneous soundtracks, which really puts the data rate beyond most straightforward technologies right now. Another problem is the things we need, the functions we need from our storage devices, like being able to play forwards and backwards and skip around and jump around in the data, don't match very well the storage medium we have. Tape and CDs are the cheapest, but you can't access them very fast. And as you can see, there's a very large jump going to hard drives or RAM. I'll be showing in the tour at the end an example of a system that attempts to combine text, video, graphics, and audio, and you'll see immediately how I hit up against some of these data rate problems. The other problem we have is that our criteria for success are subjective. As an example, the parameters we're interested in analyzing, synthesizing, like timbre, pitch, and loudness, are percepts that aren't directly related to acoustic features or sounds. And I'll give the audio an example of this.
Circularity in pitch judgment. Two examples of scales that illustrate circularity in pitch judgment are presented. The first is a discrete scale of Roger N. Shepard. The second is a continuous scale of Jean-Claude Bisset. Thank you.
last tone, pitch going up or down. Pretty much down. Is it other examples where you get this ambiguity?
Well, I mean, the important thing there is that it just sounded like it was going down forever. Never, in fact, it could have gone on for hours.
Sensation. And yeah. So the fundamental, the acoustic feature that you can analyze that's usually associated with pitch is the frequency of a fundamental, and clearly pitch perception is just another thing than sound. And we've done recently some research on that. Brian Link will be demonstrating at the end too, on why we need to use our own ears to listen to the results from analyses. Not entirely objective. The other problem we have is, in some ways, the most important problem, is in building systems that interact well with human beings. And again, we need high bandwidth, low fixed latency interaction with our hands, feet, mouth, and ears. And pretty obviously, the mouse, keyboard, and screen don't cut it for that purpose. So Mike and David will be demonstrating some unusual, from a computer science standpoint, input devices, gestural control strategies. And as David mentioned, another problem in this field is it's very multidisciplinary, so we tend to expect too much out of our graduate students, because they need to know something about music, something perhaps about their primary field, and preferably something also about acoustics and psychoacoustics. And if they can help us with transducers to help. So that's only some of the things that can help. And another major problem we have is funding. Supposing you write a paper, and we have one not too different from this, you can put two different titles on it. Harmonic sinusoid retrieval for submarine propeller speed estimation. Adaptive methods for pitch estimation of violin tones. Well, what happens is it'll be, the first one will probably be accepted in the US and the grant probably raise money based on it. The musical application though is much more likely to be funded and accepted in Europe and Japan. I'm not an expert on exactly why that is, although I think a lot of what's written about this is nonsense about something fundamental about the way Japanese think or about their culture. I just think they're smarter businessmen because they know where market volume is. And market volume is consumer products. And I think it's significant that the two fastest growing storage technologies this last decade, the Dept tape, which is becoming the standard way of backing up computer data, CD, which has become a CD-ROM drive, were both developed for consumer applications. And if you look at the history, it's always been the case that music and arts have driven technology. This is my favorite 19th century hypermedia technology. So you have graphics. You have text, it's synchronized, I guess it's upside down. And you have one of the earliest digital storage methods, which is actually a very compressed, compact notation. Instead of storing the audio, which is what we struggle to do very expensively, you record the gestures of the, and use a sophisticated synthesis device, a piano with a lot of pneumatics to play it back. I don't know whether you remember paper tape or punch cards, but they didn't look very different from this. Right, just bandwidth. Difference. In fact, if you look at the pneumatic valves are basically transistors, and there's a kind of piano called the duo arc, which has a row of four dots, which are the dynamics, the loudness. I don't know whether the coding is binary, but they have this thing which they call the brain. It seems like any new technology that people like to associate with our brains. But they had this little box called the brain in the bottom of their pianos, which was, if you look closely, a 4-bit DA converter, diagrammatically again. And I think if you think about, I don't know, let's take VLSI as an example. Whoever invented photography didn't think of photolithography as the end result. They had something far more in the area of entertainment in mind. So that's it. I'll turn things over to David for introduction to masks.
Okay. Well, what I'd like to do is spend about 10 minutes, no more, just giving some of the essential features of this programming environment. And I want to preface this by saying that today we're lucky to have Miller Puckett here, who started working on this program in about when you were actually working at MIT before. It was about 86 that the Macintosh incarnation of it got underway.
87.
And I think one of the really fascinating things about this program is that it was developed very much in a context where musicians began to use it very early on. And much of what you see in it, it was the result of very intense collaborations between Miller Puckett and Philip Mannery, who was the composer at IRCON. And so the application, the idea of not going off and building a language that was going to serve as music and somehow delivering it to the musician, this wasn't the model here. There was a very intense, ongoing interaction between the applications area and the development of the language. And I think it brought a much more interesting product out as a result. And Miller will be demonstrating the latest stuff on it downstairs with one of Mannery's pieces as an example. But let me just give you the basic idea. Underpinning Max is a scheduler. On top of the scheduler is built an object system and a graphical programming environment in which the message traffic is described by a graph that one should simply draws. Let me build for you now a very simple program. I'm pulling down an object, placing it on the screen. I get the commercial environment that was brought to market by David Ziccarelli of Opcode Systems is really very, very, very easy to use. Non-programmers can get started with this very quickly. This is an adder. I'm going to now put a display up. I'll tell you what, let me do something first. Let me get these fonts to be big and go over to a thicker one so you can see what's going on. So I pop down the adder. I'll send a number message to the adder. So now I've taken the outlet of this message box, patched it into the inlet of the addition box. I'll plop down a display object, patch the output of the adder to it so we can see what the result is. And then I'll use another input device like this to shove numbers in. Now, this object is such that the all the inlets except the leftmost one are lazy evaluators. The leftmost is what I can call an eager evaluator in the sense that it triggers the computation. So I'll load up the right inlet with 7. Notice nothing happened. And I'll spin some numbers through there. 21 plus 7 is 28, and so on. Now, the thing that's nice about the environment, then, is that you can build these things and build the user interface right on top of it at the same time. And there are lots of user interface objects that are musically related. So we might look at what addition looks like when we put a keyboard down. So what we'll do is, now we'll lock the display. Now if I play C up on that keyboard, I display a G down on the bottom. So we see addition for a musician corresponds to transposition. Another thing that Max is very good at is abstraction. We can, in fact, roll our own objects that we can use. We don't have to rely on the ones that are available. Let's say that I want to play, make something that allows me to play notes on this particular keyboard. and use it as a subpatch. Let me again bring the font here. So what I'm going to do is plop down a note out object. Misspellings, of course, it doesn't have a do what I mean system yet. And make note, I'll pick it off the menu this time. Make note is an object that somehow also displays part of the scheduling concept. If I send make note messages of the following kind, let's say a duration, I want the note to last 1 second, 1,000 milliseconds. I want it to be mezzo forte. That happens to be 60 on the MIDI velocity scale. And then I'll play a C over here and send it off to the send. Put those in. Nothing's happened. And there, the C pops out. And what make note did was send a note on signal out the MIDI port to this device, and then it scheduled up a note off signal 1 second later. Now I might use this, I might want to hide this bit of computation from myself for later use. So one thing I like to do is send it a list of things. So I'm going to unpack a list data structure that has three integers in it and shove them in the various inlets here. And notice that the system has sort of arbitrary fan in and fan out. And I'll stick an inlet on this cache. And what I can do is show you how it works from inside. I'll send this then 60, and maybe I'll make that note somewhat louder, but I'll make it quite a bit shorter. And wire it up. So, I can put the other one in, long. The last thing that got stuck in there is what's important. But I can send it in this inlet now. So I can use this anywhere else as a subpatch. Well, let me just clean this up a bit. It turns out that the environment, I'll go into the edit mode here, select all those objects and cut them out. So now I've got a relatively clean app. Let me add an instance variable too to this by putting pound sign 1. That'll be an argument. Tell me what MIDI channel I'm going to send the signal out on. So I'll save that as, we'll call it CSDE, no, we'll call it DECS player, in honor of this demo. So now if I open up a new patcher, I can plop down that particular object and use it as I would like. So I just say EECS. I could player. It found it, and I can look inside of it. It's there, and I forgot to put a variable in, so it said MIDI channel 0 by default, but I'd better add that. Say I want that to go out on MIDI channel 1. So now when I look down in there, its instantiation of this class then has been parameterized here properly to go out on MIDI channel 1. So I can now send it notes of various kinds in this list format. And I could, in fact, lay down a number of these objects as I'd like, and all of the management of the parallelism and so on be taken care of by the scheduling mechanism in Max. Now, I'd like to, in the sense of keeping this brief, I'd like to jump now to a patch that uses subpatches all over the place and demonstrate a richer patch and the sort of thing you might want to do with this, the kind of thing. And I'll make a very simple demonstration of a home-built sequencer that has some intriguing features. So, go to the demo disk. This is something that I wrote in this demonstration patch and rolled into the opcode, rolled it into the release. So it is available in all the Macs that are distributed. So what this will demonstrate what I want to demonstrate with this to you is how what a program of some moderate amount of complexity might look like. Let's start down here at the bottom where I'm managing. Well, let me show you what this does first. What it does is play. I think right now there's just a scale in there. I can stop it and start it. In fact, I can start it and stop it from the keyboard as well. So when I press and release this key, it manages the starting and stopping. So there's a key triggering subpatch here that looks for note on and note off. And then there's a device here that routes note out to different MIDI channels. So here's where you see that I've used this abstraction to go two layers deep. And this is a root object that takes a list, strips off the first element of the list, and passes the rest of the list on out. So it'd be like a cutter in Lisp, but and sending on the result elsewhere. Now, let's look inside of this part of the patch, which is the sequencing mechanism, and you'll see some of the interesting features. What happens is I'm using a score concept that's based on the following idea. It's written in a collection object. A collection object is a data structure-like object that holds it's very much like a collection in Smalltalk. There's an index on a bunch of somethings. These can be integers, floats, or symbols. And in this case, I have indexes on notes in a score. And what this is saying is the first note is played on MIDI channel 1, and it's a 60. It has velocity 67, meaning about mezzo forte. It has a duration of 500. And the time that one must wait for the next note is 500 milliseconds. And then we go to the next note, C sharp, and so it's they're all of the same length and so on, and they're all it's a nice synchronous or steady little pattern, very simple. I had them all on the same MIDI channel because some synths play it on only one MIDI channel, but we could have alternated channels. So what happens is that score then gets sent out to that note making device, very much like the one I just built. But in the meantime, I'm allowed to scale via a function the dynamic aspect, the velocities, that is how loud it's going to be, the durations of the notes themselves by a table. So I can, for example, if I want to make a crescendo, I just draw the table this way. And when I go and play the device over here, I've got a shaping device. Allows me to operate fairly intuitively on what's going on. I'll make the notes, as they get louder, I'll make them more staccato. And now why not add an accelerando? Make the tempo increase as they get louder. So the thought here is that one can sculpt and shape phrases and articulations and make the music speak or feel good. Just a little bit about the program. What happens is because I'm not operating, I'm not running this program at interrupt level, I could have, it stops when I use the mouse. Restarted it in this overdrive. See, the scheduler was. Let me stop it. I'll show you what happens if I go to overdrive. Now I can move everything around. So we're operating there at interrupt level. Okay. Now, of course, one could add and extend this quite a bit, but let me just show you a couple of features of the way the program is written. I peel off then the elements of this notes, and this was written because not everyone has a floating point unit, and these sliders and so on from the tables are just integers at the moment. We have Mike Lee here, and you'll see this, has written floating point size, we could have worked between 0 and 1 much more, but this was written for every man with any Mac. And here is the one of the interesting features. I peel off that last element of the score, which is the time till next note. I shove it into this device here, which is something that will guarantee a certain order of execution and do some data type coercion. So I send the value in to the trigger. It comes out of the right input first. It gets scaled by the value coming from the table and gets shoved in as the parameter of this delay line. So the delay now has the delay corresponding to time to next note. Then, using this right-to-left order of execution on the outlets, max, in other words, sends things out the right outlet first, and then everything's done down that tree, then it comes back and sends the next element out. All the computation hanging off that outlet gets done, then finally moves over to the left. And so I want the delay line to have been loaded up with the proper delay before it gets triggered. So I use this to send the value there first, and then I coerce the integer into a bang, which is the trigger data type in max, to start the delay line. And if my gate is open, it passes through, goes back up to this counter, and the counter is incremented, and the next element of the collection is sent out as a note. So it's a very simple message to back to oneself, but with a delay. Now, one of the other nice features of Max is that all of the objects have help files associated with them, and they're very easy to build. You just write a little document, a Max patch. Here's a demo of how the counter works. And if I look at the counter and I don't know quite how this menu box works here, I can jump and go to the help file for it. I double-clicked and got the comment box as well. So here's how the menu item works, or the pop-up menu, which is a graphical interface object. If I see something here like this sequencer, I can look at the help file for it. Here's a MIDI sequencer, and so on and so forth. So the system is entirely documented within itself with these help files that all function and can be used, in fact, as pieces of program that you just cut, copy, and paste those elements from the help file into your own programs, if you like, without... So it's a very friendly environment, and in teaching this here in Music 158 now for... this will be my second year at it, I guess the third year at it, I had, but with the full-blown Max would be the second year, students, even with no computer science background, seem to jump into this style of programming with considerable ease. So I think I've taken more than I should have, and we'll move on to the next part. One of the interesting things that is possible with Max is that you can write an arbitrary C program that does something, not a totally arbitrary C program, obviously, but you can write C code that becomes object. So it's extensible. And since we're very much interested in things like pattern recognition and the use of input devices like that aren't just keyboard driven but take continuous gestures, one of our favorite devices is the Thunder. This is a tactile controller which is built by Don Buchla, who's right in the back. This is, it has a, it's a touch sensitive surface with a pressure and position data from a number of keys, and here we're looking at continuous types of signals and gestures. Don has also developed another device that we're showing, which is a spatial controller. We also have Max Matthews' radio drum here, and we thought we'd take a stab at playing with some neural networks to do pattern recognition. And Mike Lee will talk about that. And Mike has written an external that runs in this environment. So the network work happens in a context that's performance-oriented, real-time-oriented, as opposed to something offline. Mike?
as David said, Max is a real nice environment in that it lets you write your own externals. One of the external pieces of code that we've written lately is a neural net simulator, which we call MaxNet. And I'll just kind of briefly go over a few of the features of it and some of the things that some of the few applications that we've been doing with it lately. And I'll probably give a little short demonstration if it doesn't crash on me. So I'm going to have a prompt. Some of the features you see, it's just a plain key coordinate, but it also has some of the element and Jordan recurrent net capabilities, which is pretty easy to do right away. There's a paper by Peter Todd in the Computer Music Journal that uses recurrent nets, and he does sequence generation and kind of interpolates between learned sequences, which is kind of interesting. Does the basic gradient descent back propagation. Another feature is that it has graphic display of activation levels, which is just kind of a different view of the neural nets. The way that a lot of people view the nets are kind of hidden diagrams where they show the weights, the weight matrices, and things like that. And I thought it might be kind of interesting to show activation levels so that we can play with its individual input units and see how it affects the network. And because Max is a fully interactive environment, we can do that in real time on the screen. It also can learn the slope factors of the sigmoid output units. That comes in handy if you want to do different types of applications. So the higher the slope factor, the sigmoid unit, the sigmoid function looks more like a threshold unit. Increase it, it looks more linear in this middle section there. It also has the capability to add hidden units according to a given criteria. So one of the problems with neural nets is that you have to determine structurally how it's going to look. It's pretty easy to figure out what your inputs and outputs are going to be. That's constrained by the problem. But the as far as the number of hidden units you have, that's something that people kind of guess on, or if they have intuitive feels after they work with them for a while. Let's see. There's also a companion training program called MacNet, which just lets you train a net outside of the Max environment. It runs under Unix and other operating systems, so you can train it in less time than on a Macintosh. And just for a few applications that we've been doing, the first one that we tried is this Max drum, which is this surface over here. There's five antennas on it. There's two sticks that have transmitters on it, and they transmit at different frequencies. And the antennas give you a proximity effect to the surface there, so it'll give you spatial coordinates. One of the problems that this drum has is that when the sticks are close together, you get some weird proximity effects between the signal leaking between the two sticks. So it's just some weird nonlinear function out there. We tried to use the net just to do this transformation of coordinates. It seems to work okay. Another application that we've had is lightning, which is this thing that David just introduced by Don Hoopla in the back there. What we tried to do with this is to recognize simple curves and classify them. I have a demo of that, but I don't know if it's going to run. The curves that we were able to train on are the basic 4-beat pattern, square, figure 8, and Zorro, basically, what we did was use the spatial coordinates coming out of the lightning and did some analysis on the curve using some techniques by Fu and Yu in their syntactic curve recognition work. And fed those to the net. See, another application here is we did a MIDI guitar and HyperCard type application where the MIDI guitar was able to locate HyperCard screen given a riff that you played. So we did some things by analyzing the note densities and tonal centers and things like that. And this last one that we've been looking at is Power Glove. It's the Power Glove is this cheap thing for the Nintendo made by Mattel. And currently, I've just kind of hacked it up to use the fingers on there. I intend to use that in combination with Lightning or with its own location, special location stuff. But all of this kind of comes under the, I guess all this work is kind of coming under adaptive user interface type things, where we're trying to drop this adaptive element into this musical context and try to explore different types of adaptive user interfaces for music, musical type applications. Something else worth mentioning here is the way that we're using some of these things like this Power Glove and this Magnetron, the way we're acquiring data is we have this little Mac out here. And inside the Mac there's this data acquisition board. And it's got its own 68020 on there. And so we can do a lot of the processing on the way in, and we don't have to burden the Mac with a lot of the stuff. And eventually, it would be nice to move the net onto the processor as well, just to give us even more real-time response on the Macintosh side. So, I can just show you a few examples real quick.
And then during the free period, we can take a closer look at that, because we're running
like I said, I'm not sure that it's not going to crash.
Yeah, we've had some weird bug in a serial port on that machine. It's been it decided to be cantankerous this morning.
This experiment that I set up just to see what kinds of things I could do with this simple setup. And what I have here is a Power Glove that's kind of packed up. It's got fingers that are feeding into this PDA board. And I've mounted the John Buchla's prototype wands on the top here to give me this location. It looks kind of funky. let's see if it works.
Multi-processor resonate.
So So I'm going to condense three things into a short presentation. The machine itself is that black box with the ugly fan guard on the back. And an application that runs on it, and some of the underlying operating system level software. Let's start with the machine. It's 856,000 stacked together. This is how they're stacked. These are called daughter boards or mezzanine buses. They sit on top of each other with some memory, dual port memory to talk to each other, and 56,000. One of the main goals here was to lower the cost. And so there's all kinds of tricks to get away with double-sided PC board and so on. So you can discuss. Each, there's a port, actually two serial ports on each 56,000 which are brought out to the back. So you can connect up to a total of 40 channels of audio in and out. So once we had the hardware, we need some software. And so we go up to DSP driver. It does what any other operating system driver does, which is hide your application layer from the details of the hardware, in this case 56,000, but it could be any hardware. We can't use a standard driver interface, though, like a Unix driver or Macintosh driver, because we have some special requirements in audio or music related to real time. We have to get the data from the application to the algorithms running here in a timely way. We have to be able to specify when we want the data to arrive. And the data is not, say, in a conventional driver, a seek location. It's actually a vector of parameters that you have to get synchronously into the DSP system. So this driver attempts to do all that stuff and simplify the life for the application. I'm going to show briefly MacMix and the Mac's access to the Resonate box, which will be running a set of DSP code for a synthesis technique we've been experimenting with called resonance synthesis.
Might say that this Resonate device is built by Marie-Dominique Godot and Adrian a while back, and it is actually available through Marie-Dominique Godot as well.
What we're seeing on the screen is a window in the MacMix environment, which is an environment for sound editing, mixing, and analysis. It's been growing or testing, depending on how you look at it, for the last 5 years. This axis here is, you can't see that cursor, this is the frequency, the high frequency at the top, below the bottom, right hand side. The top here is the amplitude of these resonances, and the length of the line is how long they last. So, to give you an idea, it plays, puts energy into the resonances between the cursors. So, here are some of the high frequencies, and moving down, introducing the lower resonances. some other models. That was analyzed from a blunt double bass. Here's the tubular bell. And one of the things that interests us about this model is it represents the state of a system rather than a conventional synthesizer like this one, which has two different methods of synthesis, FM and sampling. In sampling, you just store a sound in a ROM and or RAM and play it out. And of course, what that means is it's going to sound the same every time you play it. In this method, to represent the state of a resonant system, each time I put energy in the system, in this system, the system just keeps computing and do this forever, going more exponentially. The structure of these models is interesting, and we're still learning about ways of representing them graphically to illustrate this. Here's an easy case. Analyzed high note of the piano, and if you look at this region of the spectrum up here at the top, you've got this high frequency attack chink, and then here's the strings, cluster references here. So what's all this stuff? Turns out to be a very important part of the sound of the piano. It's all a mechanical thud, the keys, and you need all those, all three of those. So, another interesting thing about this method is since it represents these different timbres with the same tonal representation, you can play tricks like cut and paste between the models and interpolate between them and make hybrids. Not sure whether that works in this version, but let's try that. Base, place that in. And take the high note of that piano, paste that in. And let's take a small piece of the bell. Into all those pieces of resonances, the image of that sound fuses for you. We can obviously transpose just by changing the frequencies. Those were all derived from analyzed sounds. We've hardly started, but there's a whole territory of synthetic resonances you can create by some rule or some program. Here's some interesting ones. The resonances are implemented with two-pole filters, which have, you know, two samples delayed. So there's no reverb in the system. So it's interesting that this has a sound has a very reverberant quality, a very spatial quality. There's absolutely no place to reverberate. This one, which is a mere 17 resonances, apart from having a lot of energy in the attack, the fine structure of the amplitude afterwards is interesting. It's kind of rhythmic beating. By manipulating the spacing and frequency of the resonances, you can get a lot of control.
Yeah. I guess you don't see on the screen, but the these lines are actually coupled resonances very finely spaced.
Yeah, and then there's a couple over here. Oh, I guess I should zoom in this one. Yeah. Yeah, there's a whole, the reason there's so much energy at the attack is there's a whole cluster lined up with high amplitude. And then the beating is somewhere over here. Well, it was a big subject. Obviously, we need an environment that's a little bit more real time to manipulate these things. So I'm going to switch to the other environment that uses the DSP driver to talk to the same resonant synthesis method, which is, not surprisingly, Max. Where's that stuff? The data for that resonance is stored in a Max collection. And this should give you an idea of how easy it is to create your own resonances. It's just a list of frequency gain bandwidth triplets for each resonance. And once it's loaded in, we have some things we can control in real time. I won't go into details of how the DSP object works, but two layers down of subpatches here we go. You have a bunch of named parameters, shape, noise, input gain, pulse size. And I put faders on those. So here's the obvious one. This is the gain of that pulse exciting the system. We could wireless metronome. This is the amplitude of white noise embedded in the resonance. This is the output amplitude. We set that metronome running. This is how we transpose the old keyboard. And here's a set of transformations we can do to the resonance data itself while the system's running. This adding a value, this transposition multiplies all those gains by a scale factor you can see in here. Here we're adding a value. What that does is it stretches the partial so that they're no longer harmonic. So it's a kind of control over harmonicity. This is a control over the bandwidth of the filters. So here they're going to ring out for a long time. This is how, if you want to simulate the damping in a piano or something, you can just adjust the bandwidth, take the energy out of the system. This one is this is a spectral tilt. It's just attenuating, well, favoring the low or the high frequencies. Set up to run with multiple voices, and then the idea is you put this in the hands of musicians that build that whole control structure using the gestural controllers you've seen or keyboard to control those parameters in a performance situation.
Yeah. Okay. I think
it's a Unix box with X windows with display postscript.
It does SGI keep out of our
brains.
So it's Unix with BSD features, networking, X windows, all the things you want. Traditional strength of silicon graphics, that's the most of the market in 3D visualization. And this is the lower end box. What we're looking at is a, it has ADDDA built in and AES in and out. And I've got a microphone set up, and we're looking at a real time spectral analysis.
Say ah.
Oh.
Well, long enough
so
you can see
the so you can see. And I can pick this up and rotate it. Well, this. It's interesting to note that all the signal processing and 3D imaging and so on done by the RISC processor. So it's a fast box. It's a R3000, 30 megahertz, 30 MIPS. 4.5 megaflops, correct me if I'm wrong, basic numbers. And I know this was a cute gadget that they threw in the last one. There's a wheel that's bouncing, maybe it's some energy. And since we have 3D graphics for free, we can just put the camera on the wheel.
Is this motif?
Yes, X motif. Although we're running one of their graphics windows as a part of the X Windows system.
What's the sampling rate?
I don't know. It's got 48, 44, 1. Let me have a look at what we've got set up.
When he's not doing anything else, you're getting a fair amount of, you're getting almost every noise that he makes is being displayed. In order to keep the display moving, even if you're running a whole bunch of other things, we do throw away information and just put up a board. There's some adaptive programming.
Find our friend, point the panel, lower the input gain. It has a metering here, so I can see what I'm doing.
Here we go.
Turn the monitor off to avoid that problem. Okay. So we should be able to play that horrible saturated mess.
One, two, three, test, test.
So I'll record on another track.
One, two, three, test, test.
Yeah.
This is the green track.
So now we can select this.
This is the yellow track.
Let's say what we select.
One, two, three, test, test.
Select
But 1, 2, 3, test, test, test together.
We do a thing that's known in the industry, scrubbing. Where the sample rates change dynamically. Then you can get a feeling for where your cursor is positioned. But since we've got some horsepower here, let's look at the data in a three-dimensional form. Now that, let's get rid of the bigger. So now we have a bounding box instead of a selection.
Is this the trap? 1, 2, 3, testing.
And 3D comes with free on the box. Spin the whole thing around. There's all kinds of exotic ways of looking at the data once you've got 3D. This one stacks them one behind the other. Sorry if I'm making you seasick.
Familiar, yeah.
So those are the ones that are some of the demos that come with the machine. Here's one I snuck out of their lab there. Someone stopped me if I'm infringing or something. You will see artifacts, the standard decompression artifacts, but this should give you an idea of where.
What's the compression algorithm?
I don't know. I think they're keeping that secret, like everyone else.
It started off.
Well, it's better than MPEG, I think.
Started off from the paper, but. 2 or 3 years ago by Fontaine's graph on basically you've got about 2 bits per pixel.
So it's your own proprietary.
I'm not sure how proprietary this graph is if he's one of the founders of Steve.
Well anyway, I'm sure SGI has ranged in any new methods.
Yeah.
Something about the machine itself. It's got three devices you can slide in. In this case, I've got it set up with a DAT drive. The DAT drive is interesting because you can play audio off it or use it as a backup device. It supports both. The audio is pulled through SCSI and comes out of the DA or the AES, it's called it. But maybe in the demonstration.
Is there a
VSV? Yes, there's a 56,000, which is mainly used in all these examples as a smart BMA controller. Okay.
This is the second prototype of a hypermedia project. There are a few available commercially now. The idea is to take a regular off-the-shelf CD and hook it up to one of these drives. This is an Apple a CD-ROM drive that also plays dimensional CDs, and build a text, a descriptive text with images about the music. And in this case, I've chosen country blues artist Skip James, and I'm for our purposes here, we're really trying to explore what the technology can do rather than build complete commercial systems. The commercial systems right now are monochrome with small screens, or don't really push the imaging possibilities of a computer. I decided to do this one in SuperCard, which has color and grayscale, so I've done a lot of images scanned in grayscale. And the real reason for doing this on computers is that you have the possibility to move around the information more quickly, potentially have a lot more information than you could have, say, in a book. And you can illustrate musically things. So here's a very basic kind of link, which is the standard hypertext link. If I click on Yazoo City, where Skip James was born, it takes me to a map of Yazoo City. Go back where I came from. Here's a list of songs, so let's go and look at this song. As a little reminder of the artist. And the text of the lyrics of the song, and I can use this, which is like a tape recorder transport control panel, to play the song. And it will play the song all the way through, stepping line by line in the lyric with a selection, so you can decipher some of the lyrics, which occasionally are hard to understand. And we can also jump randomly anywhere in the song. I don't know whether you can see at the back, but he really is singing those words. The bouncing was a little jerky because I'm not an expert ball bouncer. In fact, I don't know if you know how I can find someone who does that. I don't really remember the sing-along bouncing ball things on TV. I don't know where you go to learn that talent. The way the system works is you pick up the ball and bounce it. No. And then next time you play it, it should be able to follow. Problems with these systems is you really want to have more audio than your material, source material, than you can in current technology. So just to give you an idea, one of the problems, this is a cleaned up quality 60s recordings on CD, but a lot of the interesting things this artist did were recorded on what were then very clean 78s, 1931. These days sound like this. So that material isn't available on CD, so I recorded that from a 78, well actually from a regular LP of a 78, onto the hard disk, so it was played from the hard disk. So we've been experimenting with a hybrid system where some of the material is on hard disk, and on the Silicon Graphics box we could put some material on that tape, which in a way is a better compromise. Other visual things we might want to put in a system like this include the music itself. In this case, I've just taken the underlying part of the song where you can hear very clearly the underlying rhythmic
pulse behind this song, and I've got the music in guitar tablature, so if you wanted to learn to play this, you could follow along on regular music notation. And it's looping round and round while my finger's on the mouse, so when I figure I've learned the thing, I can just let go and go back to the song. I discovered something interesting when you have a feature like that, is when you listen to the song next time around, it's not the same. You've already understood one of the layers of the song, so you can then get focus on the lyrics and other parts. So it's a very interesting tool pedagogically for focusing people's attention on features of music. And I don't know, another technology problem that hopefully will be fixed soon is that the companies that seem to have tied up getting text on computers, like Adobe and Apple and so on, haven't focused on printed word, on things for, so that things come out cleanly on a laser printer like that. They haven't really focused on things looking good on the screen. And I would like the screen to be at least as good as a magazine or a book, and we're a fair ways away from that. In this case, I deliberately chose a ugly font, which is one that's very readable on the screen, but I'd like to be able to use any font, just like any designer can in the medium of a book. And I think the answer to that is being worked on at a number of companies that has really emerged, and it's the same thing you saw here, which is this image is not drawn in computer terms, it's actually scanned from in grayscale from a book, and it's a lot more readable than an image built out of pieces using conventional font technology. And the same idea of representing text with grayscale rather than monochrome can be used to make text more readable, but no one seems to put enough research into that yet. So that's it. I can go over a little bit some of the technology here. We packed up the CD-ROM drive to get at the D to A converters and the audio stream digitally. It goes into a DSP board in the Mac, and we use that for other things, but in this case I'm just using that so I can play from disk using the D to A converters in the CD-ROM drive.
At some central location, and then people can call up. And
it turns out that since a lot of this information is text and some of these images is a lot smaller, static images is a lot smaller, you can have that locally distributed on a floppy, and the bulk of the data, the bandwidth you use is for the video music. And the music.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Oh, obviously video is the next thing to work on. That's partly why I showed that video demonstration on some graphics. Mm-hmm. Because people are getting good enough at video suppression to give a good starting point anyway.
Are you going to do that style of application on the next?
I'm not sure. I think I should explain something about this, where the technology is at. Basically, we spend a lot of our time on the bleeding edge of technology. This stuff, there are lots of nice tools, but you really push against all the limits when you develop this kind of thing. So, the Macintosh is the most mature environment. But the thing we want to do next video, they haven't yet released the pieces we need to do that. So, we'll probably be doing several projects in parallel, some on the Silicon Graphics. We did a project like this on the next, and a couple of reasons gave up. One of them is I was interested in color. The original next machines didn't have color. And there haven't been any good hypermedia environments, authoring environments on the next machine, so Silicon Graphics looks like.
And this year we're very honored to receive Xavier Rodet, who will be here for a year, beginning in a week or so. He'll be on sabbatical here from Vircom and from Darcy's, where he is a DSP person. And so he'll be a real digital signal processing resource for the Berkeley community. And he'll be arriving sometime next week. He also is heading the Mohonk session this year on music.
Regarded as an attempt to make a standardizable system for doing real-time computer music. What that's meant for us is that we've had to assemble enough hardware to do
to do general purpose processing at what we wish were a gigaflop, but which might reasonably reach 100 or 200 megaflops. We need to get this down to a size that's feasible for moving from place to place with it. When Earcom does electronic concerts, they usually hire a plane instead. And that's because the real-time synthesizer that was developed at Earcom before this one was 2 or 3 times
less than
the
at all.
And so it had a lot of loud fans. It'd be a long way away, and there were a whole bunch of cables going back and well all over everywhere. So what we decided to do this time was to try to make a RISC multiprocessor that we could try to come up with some software model to describe real-time control and synthesis on that could be independent enough of what we happen to do this generation that we can hope to resurrect the environment in future generations, in future Windows systems with different numbers of processors or whatnot. So the user interface that I'm going to show you at least is Max again, extended. The Max that you see on the Macintosh is not able to patch signals. It's able to talk about messages that flow between boxes, but depending on the Macintosh, you might get between 1 and 10,000 messages a second through that system. 10,000 might be optimistic. And signal processing, of course, requires a great many more transactions than that, but it's a great deal less. It's a great deal more repetitive. Typically, if you're running an oscillator, you'll run it for 1 million samples or so. A signal type was added to Max so that you could use Max to arrange signal processing patches, which might look like a large analog synthesizer. In other words, you would have oscillators and filters and samplers and whatnot, and you'd be able to connect them together with wires that would describe where the signals went. And the other extension that had to be made was that Max had to be worked out to run on multiple processors. But that didn't turn out to be a terrible problem because Max is a multi-window application. You can just put a control on the window to say where it is. And then the only intercommunication between processors you have to worry about is pretty explicit. It's just the inputs and outputs of the window itself, regardless of an object. Each of those inputs and outputs has to become a channel of communication between two processors. So, of course, it was horribly complicated in reality to do all this, but the idea, at least, I hope, is simple. So what I've brought today is a card, which was designed at Earcom, which we've stuck in the next down here. And the card is a dual processor using the Intel i860 pseudo-RISC processor, which we chose because we compared it to DSP chips, and it seemed to be a great deal better at doing DSP than DSP chips are. It's also a great deal harder to program DSP on than DSP chips are. The other thing is it can use dynamic RAM because it's a real computer. DSP chips typically have to use static RAM, and we want to have a big address space because we want to actually run our control code on there as well. So we need to have a real computer as well as something that does DSP. So everybody seems to be moving in the same direction. You just got to have a general purpose processor that you can spend a week coding a real fast oscillator on, but nonetheless can write a mountain of C code or Lisp code for as well. In this case, C. With that as an introduction, what I want to do is play a short excerpt of a piece starts this excerpt of the piece. And now, the score has two parts: the piano part, which starts with an F sharp, and the computer part, which is essentially doing things to the sound of the piano. So I'll play the F sharp. And that's a slightly unnatural piano note. All that is a rather slick use of a reverberator. You open a reverberator up during about a fifth of a second during the good part of the note after the attack's gone. And then you try to balance it so that as the note's fading out, the mix is such that you just hear the note extend itself. It's not a perfect illusion, but it's close. And of course, if I blow it, I live with my mistake. Until a point in the score that actually directs that particular note to stop, which is a while later. So the point to this approach, and this to me is one of the exciting aspects of computer music, is that of course you can regard the computer as an instrument, but you can regard it as an instrument that has a user interface, a musician interface that you program. Right? In this case, the question is, if the interface, I mean, if the physical part of the interface is me whacking the piano keys, what is an interesting set of ways that could really control the sound coming out of the computer? Well, of course, you control the sound coming out of the computer if it itself is the sound of the piano. In other words, I'm guaranteed that the dynamics of the computer follow in some way the dynamics of my piano playing and so on. So in some sense, I'm actually playing the computer as well as the piano. And that actually scares the devil out of pianists. But on the other hand, I think it's a music interesting professional pianist would be willing to try to do, or is often willing to try to do, in order to do something substantially different from what they've tried to do before. And maybe this will be seen as one of the interesting frontiers of electronic music, and maybe it will die out. You don't know, but it's fun being there and doing things that, as far as I know, haven't been really done before. So, of course, the piece around is 4X, which is this terribly large Earcom synthesizer, and as a test of our new system, we're trying now to port the piece into this thing, which I took in my handbag on the plane. I didn't pick the next, I just did our converters. So what I'll do is I'll play about 4 minutes of this, and sometimes I can play this in 4 minutes. I'm not a real pianist. And what the computer is really going to be doing here in this section of the piece is taking samples of the piano and either reverberating them or else playing them as a real sampler so that you can hear a periodicity or an aperiodicity in a bunch of echoes. It will be echoes of the piano, but which over time you'll hear getting further and further away from the piano because they'll be twisted in. Yes. So if you don't like the balance, just change. We'll start it.
Thank you.
Could you talk about the DSP?
Oh, about the DSP.
Part,
if that perhaps we should keep the door open so that if people want to wander in, they can do it. Because at this point,
we'll see. At this point, people might be free to wander in and out. What? This is not a beginner's example. What I did to get this far in the port of the piece is not completely ported to the composer's satisfaction, I should say. But this, the window up to about two-thirds of the way over is actually a port from a Macintosh patch. And Max on the next is actually a port of Macintosh Max. And then what I added, well, as background, the piece originally was for Macintosh and 4X. The Macintosh was running Max, doing all the figuring out, and the 4X was doing all the grunt work of feeding samples. And so the new thing that we can claim is that now we can do the grunt work and the interesting the interesting decision making really in the same programming environment and even on the same hardware. Over here now is what used to be the 4X, which is this spider webby intercommunication network between a whole bunch of different processors. There's a harmonizer, a frequency shifter, which is a single sideband generator, two reverberators, a simple vocoder, a bank of samplers, and whatever else I might have forgotten, and a stabilizer to produce some of the phasing and panning effects that you heard.
So those are actually different pieces of hardware or logically separate?
They're logically separate, but they're being run, well, they're made up of sets of 30 primitives. So these are actually patches. The harmonizer looks like this.
You, separate processes?
It's one process, and what happens is there's a magic moment when you turn everything on, and the parts of the signal processor which are on a specific processor are sorted linearly. So essentially this gets compiled down to a linear list of highly optimized function calls. And they're still function calls because that seems to work better for the cache. And they pass vectors around to eat up the overhead of getting at the function call. Okay. There's only one easy way to do this. There's one hard way to do it, too, which is really to compile the thing down to optimized code. And that's much harder. Damn, the device's too short. a harmonizer just looks like a tape recorder with two tape heads that are rotating as the tape is going by, right? They've done this in the 50s, and so you just make two delay lines, actually one delay line with two taps, and you move the tap either in or out, depending on whether you want to go up or down, but at some point you have to stop, so you fade that one out quick and fade another one at a different delay, and then just keep rolling it over like that. So, and that in Max is something that's built out of the simple primitives, which are arithmetic and variable delays and oscillators to generate the phase of the delay change. Computer music types really get heavily into table lookup.